Thank you everyone for joining me again. I'm Tani Fitzpatrick, one half of the award-winning World Footprints team. The other half is my husband, Ian, is right behind me. I have been spearheading these series as a means of connecting us and sharing information about what's really going on around the world from the perspectives of people who live in various countries and cities. And so today I'm so happy to introduce you to a very old friend of ours, Johannes Syms, who comes to us from Cape Town, right outside Cape Town, South Africa. I think the Western Cape. Isn't that correct, Johannes?
100%, yes.
Yes. Very nice to see you again. Thank you for joining us.
Welcome.
So we interviewed somebody, actually our editor, the World Footprints editor, who just left Cape Town the day before the country went into lockdown. So tell us what the current situation is now in South Africa.
I think from the authority perspective, they're taking it very serious. A lot of measures have been taken into place, especially when it comes to the health aspect. Talking about the health aspect, looking at the health minister, 10,000 health workers has been deployed in various areas. And then we've got about 60 mobile testing units that's also been deployed to various local areas, especially the dense areas, which is a sign for me that they're serious about it. Then we've got the Minister of Transport, who also implement new measures with regards of transporting of people. Here, transporting people of 10 passengers, that has been reduced to 7. Those transporting 15 has been reduced to 10. And those transporting 22 has been reduced to 15. So that's indication that our authority is serious about this pandemic.
And I know the African nations and certainly South Africa, because it's at the very bottom of the continent, the virus was trickling down through the continent. And so you're really one of the last continents to really experience the pandemic the way that we have here in the United States, or they have in China or the Asian, you know, Southeast Asian countries. That's my understanding, is that the virus really reached you much later than it did everybody else.
In the beginning, I think we as South Africans, or some of us, didn't take it up very serious. So we just went on with our own normal lifestyle. And as you know, that we as South Africans like socializing. And that was a big step from socializing to lockdown, a totally adapting of a new call of lifestyle. But yes, as the time goes, people understand it more and more, and the way how they communicate the information to the nation is outstanding.
And how are they communicating, via television, daily television reports, or radio?
Yes, radio, television, pamphlets, and obviously people that's going around to make people more aware of the current situation. Yes, it's not, I would say, that we can't move. We can move only when there's emergency, when you need to go to the shop, or even with the current situation that impacts our poor people. People can go and deliver food parcels, and that's also a way of communicating with them, obviously, precaution is taken.
And I was going to ask you about the people in some of the townships, and, you know, even the shanty towns, very, very poor people, how they're being taken care of these days.
Yes, the fact that we are people's nation, they've been taken care of like neighbors, looking after each other, caring for each other, and that's we call the Ubuntu. And that is a big step towards assisting those who are in need to make life much more easier for them. So yes, they comply, even though they are, so to say, the informal settlement areas, the poorest of the poor, but they're getting the message about the importance of complying with the authorities' instructions.
And how is the lockdown being enforced? How are authorities ensuring that people in the outreach areas, particularly, are not wandering the streets or going to their neighbors' homes?
Obviously, there's, as we spoke the other day on video, and I showed you the patrolling of the police van. Yeah, there's some officers, traffic officers, police officers, security officers that are patrolling regularly to see that people are complying. Obviously, there are those who are restless. They can't take it. It's only the fifth day. And with that restlessness, they are wandering the street, and because it's then for the security forces to take them back home. Obviously, there's also a fine. This is how serious they are. If you don't comply, there's a fine for those not complying.
And how much is the fine?
Obviously, it varies. Depends okay. on what you're doing.
I see.
Like, say, for instance, alcohol is not allowed to be sold at any outlets. That's taboo. So for those outlets that's doing it, they will get heavy fines. But walking in the street, it will be less. And you can also go to jail up to 6 months.
Oh my goodness. And so what about groceries and food? Are you able at least to go to the market?
Yes, that's what I said earlier on. It's not that strict. People can move only on those issues. If there's emergency, if they need food, they can go to the certain outlets. If they need to draw money, but it's only limited. And even when you go to shops, it's controlled.
Okay. Now, what are you doing? Because we've known you for quite some time, and you mentioned South Africans are very sociable people. I know you are home alone building out your new house. So you're doing some construction on your home. How are you maintaining your sanity, and what creative ways have you found to stay connected?
Obviously, staying connected is through Skype, WhatsApp video with the family in Holland. And back home, being alone with the family, and especially alone in my house renovating, is continue with the building process. And then I've got my homemade gym.
Oh, okay, so.
So that's to keep my fitness level. Obviously, we can't walk dogs, we can't go run. So I have to do it here in my garage to keep fit and ready for the races upcoming.
The races. So you're still training for half marathons, marathons. You're still training for run races.
Yes, definitely. But all the races are canceled due to COVID-19. All mm-hmm. the races across mm-hmm. the country. And in fact, most of the sports in South Africa.
We've seen, you know, when there's always a crisis, people come together, communities are built, you see neighbors helping neighbors, etc. What acts of kindness have you experienced or witnessed during the rise of the pandemic in your country?
Obviously, when it comes to gatherings, that's taboo. And that isolates people. When it comes to church services, that was first, it was 100 for the gatherings, then it went down to 70, 60, and it's totally shut down now. But what some people are doing, Christians are doing with the sound system, they put the sound system in the yard and then they preach or sing to the neighbors. And obviously, that's the only way we can communicate when you do some love services for our neighbors. In other words, if you do shopping and just share it with those who can't afford it or mm-hmm. are unemployed.
That's actually very ingenious, the church services. So the pastor will preach from his front yard with a sound system, and the neighbors, his congregation in the area can listen and worship.
Yes, there was quite a few that has done it. People that I know, pastors that I know. He was standing on his stoop and with the person with the keyboard and preaching to the people in the neighborhood. Others were here locally, and one of the people or members in the community thought it was a church service in the building. So someone corrected her and said, no, it's not a church in the building. People are complying with the regulations. They are at home and preaching from their home in the backyard.
Oh, that's beautiful. So I just want to back up real quickly too and ask how many cases of people who have been diagnosed with COVID-19 have there been found to date in your country? Is it rising? Is it kind of level?
Yes, the death up to date till today is only 5. The latest person that passed on was a Professor Gita Ramye. She was a well-known HIV scientist, and due to the complications, she died on Tuesday. Mm. Yes, there's a rise in the number of cases, and up to date, it has risen to 1,380.
Okay, that's a lot higher for some reason than I thought it would be. And are a lot of these cases, are they kind of scattered? Are they in the urban towns like Cape Town or more of the townships where?
It's a bit scattered, but I can't say exactly in which areas. But as far as I know, the most is in Gauteng area.
Okay. And what about the people in the medical profession? Is there enough medical supply? Is there enough hospital beds for these new cases? Is there testing that's done on a regular basis? Because those are things that we're struggling with here in the United States.
Yes, with regards to bedding, that's the reality, it's a problem. If we have an influx of patients coming, we will sit with that problem. At the moment, we don't have that situation now because our numbers are not that high. So for 1,380 for the whole country, we can still cope. But if it increases, then we will sit with a problem. With regards to the testing, as I said earlier on, 60 testing units were deployed. And these are deployed across the country for testing at certain places. And the people are well informed where they will be stationed.
Okay, so people can at least travel to the testing sites if they think they have COVID-19.
Yes, you have to first contact a certain call number and they will guide you if you suspect that you've got the virus. And they will guide you where to go, which is the closest test unit. And that will be your reason for traveling on the road. Because if you travel, you need to have papers and have a valid reason why you're traveling. Like I'm going tomorrow to my aunt's funeral. I've got already all the papers in place. So if I have been stopped or going to be stopped by the police.
I'm sorry for your loss. I didn't realize when we spoke.
No, thank you very much. No, that's fine.
When this is all said and done, because I know you are confined in your house, but you're busy.
Absolutely.
When this pandemic has lifted, what will be the first thing you do or the first place you'll go?
Obviously, I'm waiting for my wife coming from Holland. And yes, if things go well, she will go under quarantine for 14 days. I'll have to wait for that. And after that, so I'll wait till she's out of quarantine, and then we will go on a week holiday.
Oh, excellent. Where will you go? Do you know?
Not yet. I still have to look at the place where we will go. Somewhere on the coastline, west coastline, and yeah, to go and to spend time together. Seeing that she's now going to be 3 months away with the children, especially for the birth of our fourth grandchild.
Oh, yes. My goodness. Congratulations.
Thank you. The first is on his way in August.
Okay. So I know that you are on a deadline to finish your house before your wife, Rachel, returns. So yes. At least you have something to keep you busy until her return in May, I believe.
Yes, the 23rd of May, yes.
Okay. Well, my dear, thank you so much for joining me today and for sharing your story. And I pray that you remain safe and healthy, that your family remains safe and healthy, and we look forward to seeing you again in the very near future.
Yes, me too. Looking forward to see you too again.
Thank you.
Not over video, through videos, in reality, live.
Yes, me too.